Hello, everyone, and welcome into crushthestreet.com. You know, more symptoms of the economic financial mess continue to surface. You know, the Italian trouble sent the markets into a tailspin this week. I got Andrew Maguire on the line with me today, Andrew Maguire, goldtrading.com. And he's an independent London metals trader and analyst. Is an internationally renowned for his unique ability to read the precious metals markets and his specialist knowledge and experience gained over 40 years trading in the financial and commodity markets. He's got a lot to bring to the table. He's a favorite across the alternative media, people that are looking for the truth. Andrew Maguire, thanks for coming on Crush the Street with me today.
Oh, Kenneth, it's been actually great to be with you. And I'm also very pleased that I'm actually going to be able to introduce to you very shortly, and maybe in the next day or so. Unfortunately, Tom Coughlin, CEO of the groundbreaking Kinesis Monetary System, he is struggling with internet connections at this point. But this is something that I think everyone is going to want to hear about. I'm not going to steal his thunder. And I think perhaps he'll be with you in the next couple of days or so. But what it is, this is going to be, everyone's going to understand this is going to be a rear view mirror event that's going to change the way we all think of money. And while it's very helpful to see so many gold-backed cryptocurrencies appear, there's nothing to incentivize the everyday use of these cryptocurrencies. And you will see that Kinesis changes that. So that's why I'm so excited that you do get to speak to Tom.
It really is exciting. You know, it's one of those things where we're seeing the marriage between cryptocurrencies and gold here. You know, so many people in the precious metals market are looking for an alternative and just something else, just because, you know, we haven't really had that big move in precious metals. And, you know, cryptocurrencies have been such a revolutionary thing that has hit the space, you know, not 6,000 years old like, you know, gold has been for its monetary purposes, but something that links the use case for gold to the real economy here. So that is really exciting. Looking forward to getting into that. But Andrew, before we do, I'd like to talk about that first, or I'd like to talk about this first, I should say. Yields on Italy's 2 year debt rose by almost 50 basis points overnight, the biggest one-day move since 2012, at the height of the Eurozone crisis. So we're seeing, again, these symptoms rise into the market and just so many breaking points globally that are happening. And, you know, we're all waiting for the move in precious metals. And here's just another example of what is going on globally that rocked the markets. But we really haven't seen that move in precious metals that we're all waiting for. What are your thoughts on this?
Okay. And what you've done perfectly is just really focus on the elephant in the room. And that is how gold and silver is priced. Now, Kenneth, having watched many of your interviews, I know you have a lot of subscribers who are extremely interested in gold and silver, and if not passionate about them, as we are. Now, the most frequent question I receive really boils down to what is a fair price for physical gold and silver, and it's a good time. Is this a good time to purchase the physical metal? This is really the question that everyone boils down to in the end, whether it be an institutional or whether it be Grandma Brimble in Ontario. Now, these questions have exponentially increased since the bullion bank admissions of manipulation and CFT's charges and fines relating to the collusion with other banks to spoof, which is just one more of the tools which relates to the evidence we've been providing to the regulators since 2010. Now, what we're seeing now is a perfect example of this. Even though we've seen the regulators coming down and attacking various aspects of evidence that we provided years ago, and bearing in mind, we provided 88 examples of exactly where the gold price was going to fix the next day, exactly at what point and exactly what price. So let's not kid ourselves. this game is obviously, I would think, has to be officially sanctioned to some degree, because obviously these banks are under scrutiny right now. And yet we're seeing, in the face of massive tail risks that you've just talked about, we're seeing the price of gold and silver actually being contained. Now, why would that be? And I think, that's a really, really good question. So really, one thing that's been clear through the years is that a fair and honest price for gold was being circumvented by the ability to create limitless amounts of undeliverable synthetic gold and silver supply. And this is exactly, again, what we're seeing today. And this has come at a price, though, to the West. And I want to reassure people, the result is that the paper market mismatches have been and are continuing to be capitalized on by the physical markets, which have sucked out so much liquidity out of the paper markets, it's left them teetering on an ever-dwindling supply of underpinning deliverable gold. And this degree of leverage has reached unprecedented levels. So I think, yes, we're seeing what you're just talking about today. Perfect example. Why wouldn't gold and silver? It's a safe haven. We're seeing the physical market go to. For 2 days now, we've seen the physical market being very, very aggressively buying. And yet we see this synthetic supply appear out of an under-deliverable contract in the COMEX. And that's what, really, to answer your question, that is the only condition that is keeping the price of gold and silver from doing what it should do, say, on the box, which is be a safe haven store of value. And I think, you know, without droning on too much, it really does, because this is passionate to me. This beggars the question, how long can this unfair pricing system continue to dictate price? And the answer is, without something fresh to drive additional physical demand to speed up the revaluation process, it's going to be quite some time. And that's why I, as a buyer, and bear in mind that I'm no different to any other sovereign or what a central bank would be doing. We deal with some of the largest institutionals here. Why are we going to chase price when we know that the aggregated derivative liabilities have to be defended at the end of each over-the-counter month's end option expiry? And this is exactly where we're headed at 3 p.m. tomorrow. Why do you think the price is being contained? Because there's likely $1 trillion worth of derivatives out there that'll be underwater if gold closed above 1325. This way price only slowly, in the meantime, without some fresh driver, really price is only slowly stair-stepping higher. We're seeing it in the charts and paper market, but this is really just as paper market liquidity slowly leaches out. But this is where it gets interesting. Now, this is why I so want you to interview Tom, because I want him to discuss this. But the Kinesis monetary system is one-to-one backed by physical gold and silver. And by adding a yield to incentivize using gold and silver as a payment system, physical demand is about to alter the supply-demand equation. And obviously, you know, I realize this is can't be today because obviously there are issues, but Tom's going to run you through the Kinesis money system, and there are so many elements to this exciting project, but one of that is close to my heart, the sheer volume of physical gold and silver that has to be purchased to back each transaction. And given that immediately deliverable physical supply is trading at the margin, i.e. there's very little physical supply to be had at current prices, the drawing down of physical to back the Kinesis currency is no doubt going to force the synthetically priced paper gold and silver markets to reprice gold and silver. There cannot be a disconnect between the physical price and the paper price. It will instantly be arbitraged in the FX gold and silver crosses and demanded for T+2 delivery. And people forget that the unlike any other commodity, gold and silver, especially US-centric thinkers, they forget that gold and silver actually trade as a foreign exchange cross i.e. as a pairs trade, much like dollar euro, dollar pound, etc., etc. So, you know, you can be short dollar, long gold, or long gold, short dollar. It's one or the other. So really what we're seeing is no more than admitted interventions in the currency markets. And currently what we're seeing is gold being contained, obviously as part of that official process. This is not a conspiracy theory. And of course, that's all we're seeing. You cannot be one without the other. So this is the interesting thing. And so I know it's a long answer, but I mean, this is not a simple subject. This is why we're seeing gold and silver being contained today.
Yeah, lots to touch there. We navigated through a few things, which is really exciting. Kinesis is a gold-backed cryptocurrency. And that's something I do want to dive into a little more here. And then you also talked about the arbitrage on the exchanges, which again is where you see the attack, you know, where we can see that price manipulation be released. And I'd love for you to touch on that a little more, but I'll ask you this, and that is, how good of a job have these bullion banks done at suppressing the price of precious metals? And are we in a new normal? You mentioned something that this could go on for an indefinite period of time or a very long period of time. So are we in a new normal for what to expect with precious metals?
I think it's all about conditioning. Let's think about it. If we look at the historical anchors for the trend lines, the pivots, etc., that everyone looks at from a technical basis, they are anchored in a completely different paradigm. There was no physical demand, serious physical demand, 10 years ago. If there was, it was so diluted by the enormous amount of synthetic supply. Now, as we've just said, slowly, we've seen the physical exchanges, the Shanghai physical exchanges, the other physical exchanges. I sit on the advisory board for the allocated bullion exchange. We have global hubs, seven global hubs, and each one of those are physical. Now, if I want, or one of my clients, or somebody on the Shanghai exchange, or the Hong Kong exchange wants to sell physical, you first have to deposit that physical into the exchange. Well, obviously, on the COMEX, or on the over-the-counter markets, I can create that at a keystroke. I can create any amount of gold and silver. All I need to do is have put up maybe 20% margin, not even 20% margin, a fractional margin for that amount, and I can start controlling the price. Now, if then I happen to collude or just have an advantage to perhaps talk to a friend of mine in another bullion bank and say, hey, you know, perhaps we should make sure that it'd be very profitable to hold the price down, then that can be done. Simply the power of concentration. So yes, it could go on a bit longer without physical, without a fresh demand, input of physical demand. And as I did explain a little while ago, why would anyone chase price? If I'm China, if I'm a Chinese sovereign bank, if I am a competing sovereign and I'm looking to accrue physical, why am I going to shoot myself in the foot by ramping the price up until I'm ready? So obviously, at this point here, the luxury of being able to sit back, there's this kind of fine balance. But each and every day we see the amount of physical gold that is underpinning these paper contracts to be less and less and less. And it's like an inverted pyramid. It is literally, we're talking about, it is teetering on the balance. So how long can it go on? Well, it's slowly stair-stepping higher as this liquidity, paper market liquidity, flows into the physical exchanges, which are increasingly setting a physical price. It doesn't matter to my client in Shanghai or in Hong Kong, if the paper price is one price, if the physical price is actually higher than that. Now, when we're talking about a few kilos here and a few kilos there, not a big deal. But you start talking size. You start talking about 200,000 ounces plus, you're going to pay a premium, and a large premium to buy that physical. So, you know, as I say, yeah, these trend lines, pivots, etc., we can all look at them. It's a technical game. It could go from zero to 20,000. But, you know, people forget. They put their blinkers on and forget there's a physical product behind this trade. And that is where this US-centric view is starting to dislocate from the global view.
Andrew, you mentioned this arbitrage, and it really, that's what it is. It's the physical price versus the paper price, but also this marriage between the cryptocurrency and what that introduces to the price suppression game. So I'd love for you to touch on that a little more and you know, help us understand what the opportunity is in this space for precious metals, for you know, those of us who really love precious metals and believe that this is going to be, you know, a massive opportunity, a, you know, massive transfer of wealth from the financialized world into the hard asset world.
I think we all believe the same thing. We all understand there's no argument that gold has been a store of value for 6,000 years. It doesn't, fiat currencies come and go. History buffs will agree that there is only one actual effective store of value, and that is it's something tangible, and it is, of course, gold is being the store of value. But it's not, it hasn't been an effective mechanism. It hasn't been an effective mechanism of exchange. So this is why, as I say, it's so positive to see the Sprotts of this world, the Perth Mints of this world, and all of these other gold-backed cryptocurrencies come into being, because it raises awareness of gold as a store of value. But there is no incentive to spend that gold. In fact, it's Gresham's law. You are not going to spend that gold. You're tempted. You put that on a MasterCard. Do you really want to spend your gold? I don't think so. You're going to spend your fiat cash. Much before you start to spend your gold. So I think this is where Kinesis solves that issue. It takes it to the point where we create a yield around gold and incentivize the use of that gold. And I mean, obviously there is so many aspects to this, and I really do encourage people to go in and look at the blueprint on Kinesis.money. Have a look, join the Telegram group that we have going, and ask some questions about, drill down and ask some questions about this. But this currency launches on the 1st of September, and the current KVT token is available right now for people to consider to invest in. So it's just something I think that it's going to change. This is going to change the way gold and silver transact. Because it's too difficult to take a bar of gold and go down and spend it at a store. And are you really going to spend your gold when you can actually emit it into a system, create a yield, and earn from that yield as that currency travels down the system for life? And I think that's why I want Tom to come in and drill down into the detail of this. I hesitate to steal his thunder, because he is the genius that invented this.
Looking forward to speaking with him. One of the things that I would like to ask you then is, what are your thoughts on something like Bitcoin? And I know that because this is a gold-backed cryptocurrency, you might not even have to like cryptocurrency to be interested in this, in Kinesis, because Kinesis is really holding precious metals. And, you know, but for somebody who is interested in Bitcoin, they might say, oh, you know, I'm just curious what your thoughts are on Bitcoin, being that it's not backed by anything specific. It was, yeah. So what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, that absolutely, and you've touched on some really important points there. It has great utility value, much like the dollar does, has utility value, but what is its value? There is no intrinsic value to either the dollar or Bitcoin. However, when you back a currency, a cryptocurrency with gold, obviously it takes a lot of the volatility out of it, and it basically, essentially, it cannot be rigged or sent down to zero. You cannot wake up in the middle of the night and find that the price of this currency has gone below the price of gold. Or silver. And bear in mind, Kinesis also allows the purchase of silver and the transactions of silver. So yeah, the volatility aspect is one thing, but there is one issue that all of these coins, these crypto coins have, is that they are illiquid in fiat terms. So if you want out of a decent size of Bitcoin or a lot of the other currencies, you're talking about a significant price, a significant haircut, and also you're talking about a difficulty in doing that. Now, Tether exists to be able to convert, say, a Bitcoin into cash. But there's a lot of questions about the, and I'm not saying they're illiquid, but a lot of questions about, is that backed one-to-one? I mean, again, it's illiquid. I think one of the key things that Kinesis will bring to all cryptocurrencies, and bear in mind, Kinesis, it could be called a cryptocurrency, but it's actually digital gold trading on the blockchain. So it actually avoids a lot of the crypto concerns. And obviously, we all understand the blockchain is an accounting mechanism. It's foolproof. But essentially, what we're seeing here is we're creating the ability for the likes of a Bitcoin or another cryptocurrency to convert from an exchange through Kinesis into fiat. And the reason that can happen is because we're talking about a 15 trillion a year market. Kinesis has the largest through ABX, through the allocated bullion exchange, which is really where Kinesis grew out of this, the electronic bullion exchange that ABX is, and we're then able, because we have the largest liquidity providers and takers globally in the most liquid commodity on the planet Earth, it is easy for us and our liquidity providers and takers to convert something like a Bitcoin into a Kinesis currency, which forces us to buy gold or silver, and then that can be converted into fiat we have a stellar mechanism that allows something like 3,000 trades per second. I mean, so really, we've got a robust system. The liquidity that emanates from the gold and silver markets to enable other cryptocurrencies to convert through Kinesis into cash. That provides a massive solution.
Andrew, then I'm curious, do you suspect Kinesis can trade to a premium, significant premium to gold and silver? Because once it goes significantly over the spot price, would it then be, is that where the risk lies?
Well, this is the beauty of gold and silver. No, it cannot, because immediately, if we see the price of Kinesis rise above the price of physical gold or silver, it will be instantly arbitraged by these very same liquidity providers and takers. This is a fair and honest price. And so you see a premium, it'll be arbitraged. And what you'll end up with is a real offer price for gold and silver, something that actually somebody is willing to sell their gold or silver for on the day, at that hour, at that minute. And so you will never have a premium over and above the intrinsic value of this currency. And that's the beauty of it. You have to have the liquidity that gold can bring to the currency markets for that to enable that to happen. So no, a premium could not exist.
Andrew, so as we wrap up here, what are, in your opinions, I know these are hard to say, hard to put some hard prices on, but what are fair values for gold and silver here in the 21st century, 2018? You know, what is a fair number that you believe gold and silver should be trading at?
And speaking as a wholesaler, obviously, and dealing with the inputs we see today, but also seeing the divergence between the direct algorithms that we see on the COMEX, that we see tick for tick trading up and down against the dollar index, versus the divergence we're seeing now in the FX gold markets, gold and silver markets, where we're seeing offtake come off. So I tell you what, I could possibly not predict, even as a wholesaler, I couldn't predict what the fair value of gold and silver is. None of us honestly know. But speaking as a wholesaler, I know that gold and silver are fundamentally grossly underpriced. And that's not just my view. This is the view of all my institutional clients, including the very largest global fund in existence. So, you know, these are people putting their money where their mouth is and starting to already accrue the physical product, and it completely ignore using paper discounts to accrue. And I think what I really was trying to convey is that the liquidity in the paper markets is now become so leveraged and so thin, based upon a pinnacle of physical supply. And if you remember that this is not a time like the year 2000, where Governor George from the Bank of England said, "We're staring into the abyss. If the gold price rises any more, then there are going to be some big houses taken down." I mean, essentially, that's what he said. Well, there is no physical. In those days, there was physical gold. We could take 400 tons out of the UK, flog it into the marketplace, and solve the issue. What was that? Bailing out a bullion bank. I think it's gone beyond bailing out bullion banks. I think what's happened is that the bullion banks, there are six primary bullion banks trading on behalf of the, we call them the officials, Bank of International Settlements. And essentially what I'm pretty sure they have a free pass, because some of the positions, the size of positions that we see executed exceed position limits on the COMEX on a regular basis. So to me, it's a really an absolute assurance that these banks are acting on behalf of officials, and that basically what's happening here is that we're reaching a point where how much more liquidity can be sucked out of the paper markets before this whole thing implodes. And I'm not saying that's going to happen tomorrow, but I'm saying it's going to take the likes of a Kinesis currency that is going to be utilized, going to utilize a 6,000-year-old currency, the gold and silver, and that is going to force the physical buying from the ground up. I'm not talking about hundreds of tons of supply being demanded from the top down, because that will be interfered with. This is talking about, we're talking about the power of adoption from the Indonesian post office, from 100 million members of Sharia compliant NU, this organization NU. We're talking about the unbanked. There's 25% of all Americans are unbanked. 75% of Turkish citizens are unbanked, and even more in Indonesia. So we now solve the problem and allow the unbanked to be banked.
I love it. Andrew, if people want to learn more about what you're doing, who you're involved with, how to follow your content, please let them know where they can go, what they'll find, and please share some closing thoughts here as we conclude this interview.
Yeah, and I strongly suggest if you look at, it's kinesis.money. I'll send you the link, kinesis.money. There's a blueprint there. It covers all of the details, all of the yields available. There's four multifaceted yields available. And there's also an ability to invest in a token now that provides 20% revenue of all Kinesis future currencies. So this is an exciting time. That launches in July. So it's a very pertinent time. So I will send you the link for that. And please join our Telegram group. There's a few thousand members there. Come and ask any question you like, and we'll get them answered for you. And it's going to be an exciting time. But as I say, I'm very excited that you're going to be interviewing Tom, and he will really, really, really rock your boat.
All right. Looking forward to it, Andrew. Andrew, thanks for coming on Crush the Street. You're an exciting guest, and it was a pleasure doing this interview with you today.
You know, it's been great, Kenneth, and look forward to joining you again in the future.